Growing the world's renewable energy capacity has always been a delicate balancing act, and one of the many plates that we have to spin during that act is land use. Utility-scale solar and wind parks are rapidly expanding in size and prevalence all over the world, including right in my own backyard. But it's not just NIMBYism that complicates the creation of clean energy. It's serious environmental and social concerns, too. When are the negative impacts of siting these massive projects worth the benefits, and when are they not? With these questions in mind, it's tempting to wonder, how much solar power could we squeeze just out of rooftops? Could rooftop solar single-handedly provide us all the energy that we need while avoiding legal hassles and ecological consequences? At the end of the day, do we have enough space for solar? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Surfshark, but more on that later. And we've discussed a lot of fascinating possibilities for increasing and improving solar power on the channel, from more simple modifications to the downright fantastical. But if you've been watching for a while, you might have noticed a pattern in the tech that I cover. The most persistent barrier to widespread use is usually cost, at least for now. In the case of going all in on rooftop solar, it's not so simple. Instead, it's a matter of priorities. Let's take a step back for a second, though, and talk about why you'd want to pitch a cover-all-the-roofs approach in the first place. Utility-scale solar is definitely preferable to coal, but there's many more considerations at play than just aesthetics when breaking new, old ground. Now, for one thing, as they're being built, solar farms can soak up a lot of water, thousands of acre-feet's worth. In some areas, that means these construction projects threaten the water supply for locals who rely on aquifers, which are difficult to monitor and preserve. Unfortunately, the same areas that have lots of sunshine to spare also have limited water resources to live. Then there's the other ways surrounding life is disturbed: construction noise, dust storms, glare, and of course, displacement of wildlife. So when an undertaking like the Arantina Solar Center involves destruction of state-protected Joshua trees in California, it's not unreasonable to question whether going forward with large-scale construction is the best decision. And by no means is this the only solar farm facing opposition from neighboring communities and conservationists. Trust me, there's some in my area too. Even when these proposals successfully clear the tangles of bureaucracy and public comment, it still takes a long time to get them online. This is especially true in the US, which is currently suffering from a grid connection backlog longer than a CVS receipt. Before utilities can move forward with their plans, they need to undergo an impact study. Off they go into what's known as the interconnection queues. Over 95% of the projects idling in these interconnection queues are for renewables, with solar representing the vast majority of them. And by the end of 2023, the combined generation capacity of projects waiting for an assessment amounted to nearly 2.6 terawatts, which is more than double the US's existing generation capacity in total. Not all of these solar hopefuls make it to completion. In fact, most don't. So yeah, you could say that we're a bit behind. However, rooftop solar can easily skip over a lot of those obstacles. While I can tell you from personal experience that investing in solar panels definitely doesn't spare you from permitting hell, it's not like you have to get in line for an impact study. You're taking advantage of space that you already have to work with rather than carving out more land, and you can use the power that you generate on site so you're not at the mercy of transmission lines. So what if we went all in with rooftop solar? How much of our energy supply could come just from rooftops alone? Now, before we try to answer that tricky question, there's another piece of tech that is not tricky and can really help you with your daily digital life, and that's today's sponsor, Surfshark. I've been using Surfshark for what feels like forever and get so much use out of it. I was recently in Canada visiting a wind farm to see how construction is done and used Surfshark in my hotel room to make it look like my IP address was back here in the US to stream some TV shows. Surfshark is a fast, easy-to-use VPN full of incredible features that you can install on an unlimited number of devices with one account. But that's not all. Even shopping services will sometimes gate prices based on your location, so you can change your location to make sure you're getting the best deal. They also have add-ons to their VPN service to unlock things like Surfshark Alert, which will let you know if your email or personal details like passwords have been leaked online in a data breach. Now, right now, they're running a special deal. Use my code UNDECIDED to get up to 4 additional months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. I've been using Surfshark for years, and I love it. Links in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. So what if we went all in with rooftop solar? How much of our energy supply could come from rooftops alone? Well, I can't tell you, not right off the bat anyway. Simply hypothesizing what we could possibly generate with rooftop solar can't adequately be diluted to a single statistic, even when you apply limitations like only covering a specific region. There's just too many variables to account for, so it's no surprise that researchers have been trying to answer this question for years. I can't give you a meaningful back of the envelope figure for how much rooftop solar has to offer on a fully realized scale, but what I can do is break down how researchers have been tackling the subject, and that would be through various measures of potential. Even the concept of potential itself has multiple subtypes in terms of calculating what we can accomplish with renewables. As a result, you end up with different values depending on what kind of potential that you're looking at. If you imagine a pyramid of potential, like the US National Renewable Energy Laboratory has here, then the foundation begins with the physical constraints of rooftop solar. How much radiation is hitting the rooftop in the first place? Of course, the total amount of radiation that a surface receives currently can't come anywhere close to the energy that it ultimately produces, and that's not just because of the solar panel's Shockley quasar limit. That brings us to the technical potential of solar. What is a particular system capable of in a particular environment, and how well does it perform? Well, here's the thing. As the NREL defines it, technical potential estimates what you can physically deploy without regard to market, economic, or policy constraints. In other words, laying out a technical potential figure for rooftop solar doesn't provide a full picture. We still have to contend with how costs, policies, regulations, and public response restrains what it can actually do for us in the real world. To PV or not to PV? That's the question. For an example of how the differences between the potential and the possible shake out, we can look at a 2016 study published by researchers from Yonsei University in Seoul, Korea. The research team zeroed in on the capital's Gangnam district.
Oppan Gangnam Style.
Yes, that one. And their analysis followed a three-step process of determining the area's physical, geographic, and technical potential. Within this particular study, physical refers to the total solar radiation of the rooftop, geographical equates to the available rooftop area for solar PV installations, and the technical potential is the final electricity generation. So here's a summary of results which represent annual values. The physical potential was about 9.2 million megawatt hours, the geographical potential was about 4.9 million square meters, and the technical potential was about 1.1 million megawatt hours. Note that the geographic potential is expressed in meters squared, not megawatt hours, because it represents the average amount of rooftop area compatible with solar panels. So you can tell right away that there's a big gap between the physical and technological potentials. As the researchers write, only 12.17% of the physical potential can be generated as electricity. That doesn't mean that rooftop solar isn't worth it, though. To put that number into perspective, CEIC data estimates Seoul's all-time highest use of electricity between January of 1997 and May of 2018 fell within August of 2016, the same year as the Solar Potential Studies publication. That number was an average of 4.8 million megawatt hours. Just like that, rooftop solar in one of Seoul's 25 districts could cover a quarter of the entire city's energy needs. That's impressive. However, my point is that the study shows how establishing the suitability of rooftop solar is a layered and laborious task, even for a single region. That's not to mention all the other circumstances that can make or break the viability of rooftop solar, including the quality of life considerations that drive its acceptance by the people it's meant to serve, which we went over earlier. It's not just about solar's literal star power. Researchers also have to take into account factors like this. Basically, you can't avoid making assumptions. And depending on what kinds of assumptions you make, your theoretical solar power potential could vary wildly. That's how estimates developed by one research team can differ from others in orders of magnitude. You can see how pronounced these differences are in this graph from a review of rooftop solar potential studies. So it's hard enough collecting and refining the approximations necessary to make an educated guess about solar potentials, but no matter how precise your data is, theoretical plans can't predict the future or anticipate every community, government, or individual decision. You might discover the ultimate solar site, but not have any policy incentives available to do anything with it. NREL pretty much sums it up in a study about community solar published earlier this year. Realistically, the potential accrual of benefits is a fraction of those high-end estimates based on technical potential capacity. So where do we go from here? Well, the truth is that weighing the trade-offs between utility-scale solar farms and a widespread rooftop offensive might be missing the forest for the trees, or maybe the sun for the rays. Because so much of solar's efficiency is location-dependent, it doesn't make sense to broadly advocate for one over another, and we don't have to stop it either. Panels can infringe on the ecosystem they're installed in, but they can also directly enhance it. Agrivoltaics, for example, enables us to create a symbiotic relationship between farming food and solar generation. Panels can protect crops from the elements, reduce water usage, provide shade for animals, and act as hubs for attracting pollinators, which happen to be the most common application of agrivoltaics in the US. I've got a whole deep dive video on the practice if you're interested. There's also practices like solar grazing or letting livestock loose on fields full of solar panels and having them go to town. By partnering with sheep and cows, we can cut down both overgrown lawns and maintenance costs as they take over the otherwise expensive role of groundskeeper. If the concept of solar over soil gives you the warm fuzzies, I've gone into more detail about augmenting agriculture this way on the channel before, so you know what to do. Now that we've gone over land, what about water? Let me float an idea by you. Photovoltaics or solar panels that catch current in more ways than one. And any kind of water will do, from the open ocean to lakes. But we can get some of the same flexibility enjoyed by rooftop solar by integrating panels into all sorts of architecture, including irrigation canals and dams. A while back, I took a deep dive into the flow of canal photovoltaics projects from India to California. Since then, similar efforts have kicked off in Oregon and Utah in the US earlier this year. And just this summer, the Philippines inaugurated its largest PV irrigation system yet, the first built over a canal. And if you saw my video on small hydropower, you might remember our discussion of one particular hydro titan, the Itaipu Dam along the borders of Brazil and Paraguay. The dam already provides about 90% of Paraguay's electricity and 15% of Brazil's. In a study published in May, the consulting firm PSR argues that the hydroelectric plant's existing installed capacity of 14,000 megawatts could be nearly doubled by setting aside just 10% of its reservoir surface area for floating PV. That's not to mention the sunny spectrum of solar niches like sound barriers, balconies, billboards, fences, footpaths, heck, even monuments. By 2025, Amsterdam will allow for solar panels on roofs within protected areas of the city. How's that for in my backyard? Should we come up with a new term for this? Imbyism, maybe? Just drop the N? Once you start to examine how social and economic influences can help or hinder solar's technical potential, it quickly becomes clear that our main conflict isn't space. It's a deceptively simple plan to cram as many solar panels onto as many rooftops as possible. It's much more difficult to assess priorities and anticipate impacts on a case-by-case basis. But if solar's massive spike in deployment, long-term drop in cost, and overall technological maturity hasn't amounted to anything, it's that we're not at all short on options. So yes, we do have space for solar that doesn't require clear-cutting large swaths of land. Dual-use implementation looks like it's the key. But what do you think? What dual-use solar implementation piqued your interest? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to listen to my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined. We'll keep this conversation going. Thanks as always to my patrons for your continued support, and a big welcome to Ricky, Mark Loveless, Aaron Adelman, and Bill Northrup. I'll see you in the next one.